Hey everyone, welcome to Anchor Church. I'm Anuhea, and we're so stoked you decided to join us today. Here at Anchor Church, we'd love to help you develop your unique spiritual giftings and grow in your relationship with God. We know that God created you on purpose and for a purpose, and our heart is to help you discover and live out the life God intended for you to live. So if you're new to our church and want to be known by us, just text the number on the screen and we'll help you get connected. And if you need prayer, please text that same number. If you want to get really connected here at Anchor, a great place to start is at Growth Track. We talk about Growth Track a lot around here. It's a two-session class that we hold the first 2 weeks of every month. In it, you'll learn about how God has uniquely created you and find out how you can get involved here at Anchor Church. We'll be meeting in person during our 9:15 service starting next Sunday on December 5th. You can sign up for Growth Track on our website or app. Thank you to everyone who has been a part of transforming our campus for Christmas. Last year, we started our Christmas Splendor tradition with a drive-through event. This year, we have an interactive experience. Let's head behind the scenes with Pastor Trevor as he and the team get ready for the event.
Hey everybody, Pastor Trevor here. We're setting up for Christmas Splendor. I want to take you on a behind the scenes look at what it takes to put on Christmas Splendor at Anchor Church. Let's have a look. Jessica, what are you doing?
Making bows.
Yes, staining this fireplace right here, trying not to get it on.
You're wearing the wrong clothes for staining today.
Yeah. I didn't know I was staining today, but yeah, and then listening to this new Adele album, because I've heard it's good. But...
Morning, Robin.
Good morning, Trevor.
What's your plan for today?
Gosh, I'm not sure yet. I gotta go talk to the boss.
Ho, ho, ho.
Cindy, what you doing?
Hey, fluffing.
We are fluffing, Trevor.
What are we building?
Yeah, we're making some windows. And this facade. It's gonna be grand.
Josh Colson, where are you going? What you doing, Josh? Dan, what are you doing?
I'm fluffing.
Fluffing?
Yeah.
You're really good at it.
Thanks.
This is gonna be a multicolored, like, gingerbread house right here. And these three guys here are gonna turn this into crazy beautiful. Just watch it.
What's happening in this area?
Hey guys, this is Santa's cabin. It's gonna be a perfect spot for photo ops in front of the fireplace, place on the hearth. Christmas trees, windows, decorations, yeah.
Everybody, this is Ed. Specialist, ribbon specialist, garland specialist. Did Rob tell you guys where you're helping out yet? Lights on poles. Thank you guys for coming out and making it. So what are we doing?
Center stage.
You know what we're actually putting on here?
I don't know.
I hear live music.
Hey everybody, thank you for watching, and I just wanted to say thank you to all the volunteers that are making Christmas Splendor happen. You guys are champions. We couldn't do this without you. And wanted to remind you that the first three Fridays in December after our Friday night service, you can come and enjoy Christmas Splendor. The reason why we're doing this is to create an atmosphere where you can invite your friends. There's gonna be snacks, there's gonna be entertainment, and there's gonna be tons of decorations where you can just experience the beauty of Christmas and just the atmosphere that we're trying to create. Hope to see you guys there. Take care. Merry Christmas.
That's all, folks.
So mark it on your calendars. Christmas Splendor is happening on December 3rd, 10th, and 17th. This is a great opportunity for you to invite your friends and family to service with you on Friday and then stay for food, entertainment, and cozy drinks. We hope you'll be able to join us for that. We are also looking for volunteers to serve at our Christmas Blessings event, where we are handing out gifts out to our keikis and seniors in our community. If you would like more information on how you can be involved, email corbin@myanchor.church. With that, let's pray for worship. God, thank you so much for our ability to gather in this way virtually and the ability to praise you together, God. I pray that you would receive our worship here this evening as an offering back to you, Lord. And I pray that you would prepare our hearts for what you have for us tonight. In Jesus' name, amen.
You're never gonna let me down. nothing now. I don't always understand. I don't always get to see everything. When I'm holding up my head, when I'm counting every breath, Lord, all I need to know is you choose me. You choose me. I'll praise before my breakthrough, till my song becomes my trial. I'll sing because I trust you. I'll bring my heart, I'll lift my soul. And I'm listening for your voice, and I'm shutting out the noise. I know that you will speak clearly. When I'm living out my faith, when I'm stepping on the sea, I know you take my hand and walk with me. Walk with me. I'll praise before my breakthrough, till my song becomes my triumph. I'll sing because I trust you. I'll bring my heart, I'll lift my soul. I bring everything I have, God, everything I am, Lord. He who came in power, he will come again. He will
are here, moving in our midst. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you, I worship you. Keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, mending every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you. In the darkness, my God,
that is who you are.
Savior, waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. Darkness, my God,
that is who you are.
That is who you are.
You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper,
light in the darkness,
my God, that is who you are.
Sing even when. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it,
that you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Thank you so much for believing in the mission and vision of Anchor Church, and most importantly, trusting God in a powerful way by returning a tithe back to Him. Tithing is saying, I trust you, Lord. And as many of you know, incredible blessings happen as a result of that trust. Let's pray for the tithe. God, thank you so much, Lord. As we offer these tithes back to you, Lord, I pray that you would take it and multiply it beyond what we can possibly dream or imagine. I pray that we'd be able to see the fruit of what you're doing through these offerings that we surrender back to you, God. And we thank you for allowing us to be a part of what you're doing in this world. In Jesus' name, amen. We are starting our Advent series this weekend as we prepare our hearts and minds for Christmas. So now take out your notes and get ready for the rest of service.
Hey guys, welcome. We are starting our Advent series and I get to kick it off. Thanksgiving is done and so now we are in full-blown Christmas mode. I hope you're not stressed out. I hope you're gonna enjoy this season. We're gonna just start this series and today I get to kick it off talking about the wonder of Christmas. I hope you guys enjoy this season. I love it. I mean, one example is on November 1st, the day after Halloween, it was a Monday. It was the first day of school. My youngest daughter, Hazel, wakes up. She gets dressed. She's in her full-on Christmas dress. I mean, she's going for it. She had the elf ears on. On the way to the car, she's like, you know, my clogs don't work. My Crocs don't work. We need to get Christmas shoes. And so here's my daughter, which is reflecting my heart for Christmas because I love it. She was ready to go. But I love the wonder of Christmas, and that's what we're going to be talking about. This season is so special. It's got the lights. It's got the Christmas trees. You know what I've done? I've discovered how to make my own homemade eggnog. And you know, I love it. It's like, it's full of wonder. It's full of those warm and fuzzies. Actually, I want to show you something that when I was a kid, I don't know if you guys grew up. I used to watch the Charlie Brown Christmas Story. Actually, I didn't watch it. My parents actually bought me the record. And so, you know, remember the days when you couldn't watch the show that you would want right when you wanted to, that you have to wait for the show to come on? Well, my parents bought me this record. This record is super old. I have the Charlie Brown Christmas record. And man, I remember when I was a little kid, I used to put this thing on because I was like, let's get into the Christmas spirit. And I remember putting it on the record player and I would hear that song. Maybe you guys recognize this song. Christmas time is here. I mean, that to me was, I mean, I was pulled in into Christmas mode, the full of wonder. And that, to me, when I hear that, it still gives me that, man, that old childhood Christmas feeling. And so we're talking about the wonder of Christmas, and I looked up the definition. I like to do that. And here's the definition of wonder. It says here, it's a feeling of surprise mingled with admiration caused by something beautiful, unexpected, unfamiliar, and inexplicable. I love that definition. And I mean, think about it. In Christmas time, we see a lot of beautiful things. I mean, here at Anchor Church, we're gonna go full blown with all the lights and the trees. And I love it up here at Anchor Church, coming up here, seeing the lights. It's special when you go to the city hall or just if you're decorating your home. I mean, there's a lot of beautiful things to look at. But here's the thing, I looking at this definition, a lot of things don't fall in the unexpected, unfamiliar, and inexplicable category. I mean, for example, my kids now want to watch Home Alone every single Christmas, right? So that's what we watch. It's almost on repeat. They watch all the three versions of it. But here's the thing. I already know the ending. It's not unfamiliar. It's not unexpected. I know what's going to happen. That little kid is going to work those robbers, and that's Christmas. But here's the thing. Here's the thing that I want to stress today is that if you strip all those beautiful things, the lights, the Christmas trees, the eggnog, the Home Alone, you know, all that, Christmas is still filled with wonder. Why? Because of the story of the birth of Jesus Christ. It's filled with these unexpected, unfamiliar, inexplicable things that when you just read the story and you see those miracles and you see the things that happened, the things that brought about the birth of Jesus Christ, our Savior, you can't help but be filled with wonder. And so here's my point is that Christmas, the wonder of Christmas, is found in Christ. And we're going to be looking at one story. This is in our Advent stories. We're going to be looking at characters and events. And the event that I'm looking at is the event of the wise men, is when they came to visit the baby Jesus. And to me, this story is filled with the unexpected, the unfamiliar, the inexplicable, the unexpected, the unexplainable things, and which in turn, when we read this story, should fill us with wonder. So let's look at this story and at this wonder-filled event. And so the one thing that fills me with wonder is the miracles. And so let's read it. In Matthew 2, verse 1, it says this, Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the reign of King Herod. About that time, some wise men from eastern lands arrived in Jerusalem asking, where is the newborn king of the Jews? We saw his star as it rose, and we have come to worship him. So here's the first miracle that fills us with wonder. The wise men showed up. I mean, that to me is a miracle that they showed up in Jerusalem. They're like, where's the king? Where's the newborn king? We heard about it. We're here to celebrate him and give him gifts. And so the one thing that I want to tell you guys is, In the language here, they were called magi, right? This is what we call wise men. So the magi back in those days were magicians and astrologers. This whole sermon, I'm gonna blow up your nativity scene. They were not kings. They were wise men. They were actually astrologers. They helped probably the kings to predict things and to help them govern and all that, but they were not kings. They were from the east, most likely from the Babylon area. And here's the one thing, like I told you, I'm gonna ruin your nativity scene. It doesn't say how many wise men there were. We say there were three wise men, but it could have been two. It could have been 30 of them. The only reason why we say three is because of the number of gifts that they gave to Jesus. But I think the biggest question, and I think why this is a miracle, is how did they know? Why did they show up in the streets of Jerusalem looking for this newborn king? What led them there? And, you know, scholars believe that there was a prophecy given way back in the time of Moses in the Old Testament. When Moses and the Israelites were wandering the wilderness, they're about to enter into the promised land. And there was this prophet named Balaam, who was actually from the east. He could have been from Babylon as well. And there was the king of Moab who saw the Israelites coming, and he said, you know what? This king Balak, he said, you know what? We need this prophet Balaam to come over here, and I want him. And he asked Balaam to curse the Israelites because he didn't want them conquering their land or occupying their land. So he asked Balaam, can you curse them? But here's the one thing, Balaam, who hears from God, actually ends up blessing the Israelites. And it says it here. This is a very powerful verse. In Numbers 24, verse 15, it says this. This is the message Balaam delivered. This is the message of Balaam, son of Beor, the message of the man whose eyes see clearly, the message of the one who hears the word of God, who has knowledge from the Most High. I mean, he's already establishing, this is who I am, who sees a vision from the Almighty, who bows down with eyes wide open. I see him, but not here and now. I perceive him, but far in the distant future. And get this, this is so powerful. A star will rise from Jacob. A scepter will emerge from Israel. It will crush the heads of Moab's people, cracking the skulls of the people of Sheth. I'm sorry, I'm laughing there, but it's just, it's here, it's like this. The king was asking for a curse, and it backfired on him. And Balaam gives this incredible prophecy. And so here's a guesstimate that why did the Magi, these wise men, show up in Jerusalem looking for the newborn king? Well, the guess is that they knew about this prophecy. What does this prophecy say? That a star will rise from Jacob, a scepter from Israel, which means a king. Royalty will rise from king. And then above that, he will deliver Israel from the hands of their enemies. Wow. This is a huge prophetic word given by Balaam. And so the guesstimate is that's how the wise man showed up. And I think the miracle is this, is the miracle is that however they heard about it, they were looking. They were looking for Jesus, and they were looking for the star. And you know what? More than just finding the star, they moved. They were drawn to action. Like, we have to go celebrate. We have to go visit this newborn king that is going to deliver Israel, and we have to honor and worship him. And here's the side note, which I think is very important. You have to note that these were Gentiles. These were pagans. They did not worship God in their nation, but they believed in God because of this prophecy, and they came. And to me, this is means a lot because of the fact that here Matthew, I think he's doing it on purpose. He's saying that because of Jesus, now everyone who seeks him from all nations, just not just from Israel, all people from all nations can come if they want to seek Jesus the Savior. I think that's pretty cool. The second miracle that we see that fills us with wonder is the star itself. I mean, it's in that song, right? We Three Kings, which they got it wrong. That's okay, I'm sorry. Is they call it the Star of Wonder. And so what happened when the wise men showed up into Jerusalem? Well, the king at the time, King Herod, heard about it. And so he welcomed them and interviewed them and started talking about them. And so, and then after the interview, we catch up to the story in Matthew 2, verse 9. It says this, after the interview with King Herod, the wise men went on their way. And the star they had seen in the east guided them to Bethlehem. It went ahead of them and stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were filled with joy. Now, let's put this into, like, just put this in your head. Imagine what happened. They were in Babylon, in the east. They saw this star rise, which they were looking for. They're like, wait, this matches up with the prophecy that we heard. Here's the star rising. And so they ended up in Jerusalem, which says to me that they didn't know exactly where the newborn king was. They kind of knew the general area. They showed up here. It's like, okay, and I can just picture them going, did you see the newborn king? Do you know where he is? And maybe that's why King Herod heard about them, because they were asking everybody where this, so they didn't know where it was. And so after they talked to King Herod, the star started moving. So it rose and then it went, which is, if you look at the maps, Bethlehem is maybe about 5 miles away from Jerusalem, and it led them down into the city of Bethlehem. And how's this? It stopped. It stopped above the house where Jesus was. So imagine this star rising and then moving and then going and stopping. To me, that is the star of wonder. That is a miracle. And so here's the thing. So many people have tried to figure out what is going on here. I remember hearing a sermon all about it. This is exactly what they trying to figure out. Was it a supernova? Was it the conjuncture of planets? And, you know, it looked like a moving star. Was it, you know, what they tried to, looking at the stars, figure out how this happened. And I think that's great, but here's my thing that I want to tell you, that there's some things that we can't figure out. Maybe they figure it out if that planet conjuncture happened at that time, but I think the miracle still remains that God did it because of the perfect timing of it. I think that is the miracle in itself, that it was timed, however it happened, exactly at the time when Jesus was born, and it led the wise men to the exact house. And to me, I think there are some times we just have to go, you know what? I would love to figure that out. But remember the definition of wonder is, one of the definitions is it's inexplicable, which means it can't be explained. And I love the fact that I worship a God that is inexplicable. I can't explain him. Here's my finite knowledge, my brain, and here's who God really is. That, which means I can spend my whole life figuring out who God really, really is. And here's what I believe, that we worship an inexplicable God that does inexplicable things. We can't explain the things. And to me, that gives me wonder. Wonder builds my faith. I mean, look at how the wise men reacted in the scripture. They were filled with joy, which means they saw it. They're like, whoa, here's the proof. It's leading me to the exact house. Can I say it this way? They were filled with wonder. They were going, we can't explain this. We are actually astrologers and we can't explain this. And now it has led us to the newborn king of the Jews. I think that's pretty amazing. Don't get caught up. Keep that wonder, keep that faith. The second thing that brings wonder to this story is to me the warnings, which in itself is miracles. But I wanted to separate it because I feel like it does say something about this story with the wise men and Jesus. These warnings, there were warnings that happened. And so, like I said before, the wise men showed up in Jerusalem. They're probably talking about it. And so King Herod heard about it. And so King Herod brought them to interview them. And it says this, we're backing up back to verse 3 in Matthew 2. It says this. It says, King Herod was deeply disturbed. Take note of that. King Herod was deeply disturbed when he heard this, as was everyone in Jerusalem. He called a meeting of the leading priests and teachers of religious law and asked, where is this Messiah supposed to be born? In Bethlehem in Judea, they said, for this is what the prophet wrote. And you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are not least among the ruling cities of Judah, for a ruler will come from you who will be the shepherd for my people Israel. Then Herod called for a private meeting with the wise men, and he learned from them the time when the star first appeared. Then he told them, go to Bethlehem and search carefully for the child. And when you find him, come back and tell me so that I can go and worship him too. Here's the problem. King Herod had no intention to worship Jesus. He was an evil man, not a good man, and his intention was to hold power and not have this little baby take power from him. So he wanted to get rid of him, to kill Jesus. That was his intent. And so here we go down to verse 12, and we see these warnings. And it says this in Matthew 2, verse 12. It says, when it was time to leave, so this is after the wise men visited with Jesus, gave him the gifts. When it was time to leave, they returned to their own country by another route, for God had warned them in a dream not to return to Herod. God knew Herod's heart, and wanted to protect the Magi. More than that, it says this in verse 13. And bear with me, I'm going to read this to the end of the chapter here. It says, after the wise men were gone, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream. Get up, flee to Egypt from the child and his mother. The angel said, stay there until I tell you to return, because Herod is going to search for the child to kill him. Wow, here God knew exactly what was going on, and he gave a warning to Joseph. That night, Joseph left to Egypt and the child and Mary, his mother, and they stayed there until Herod's death. This fulfilled what the Lord had spoken through the prophet, I called my son out of Egypt. Herod was furious when he realized the wise men had outwitted him. He sent soldiers to kill the boys in and around Bethlehem who were two years old and under, based on the wise men's reports of the star's first appearance. Herod's brutal action fulfilled what God had spoken through the prophet Jeremiah. A cry was heard in Ramah, weeping and great mourning. Rachel weeps for her children, refusing to be comforted, for they are dead. So here's warning one. God told the wise man, don't go back to Herod. Warning two, an angel appeared to Joseph, take Jesus to Egypt because Herod is going to kill him. This is a sad story. Actually, the scholars say that around maybe 10 to 20 children under two were murdered by Herod to try and get rid of Jesus. But Jesus was safe because because Joseph was warned by God. And here's the thing, and this might sound weird, but this part of the story fills me with wonder. I know it's not the warm and fuzzies, and I almost want to remind you that the Christmas story is not full of warm and fuzzies. That the reality is that God sent Jesus to invade an evil and a sick world, a world that was self-serving, that was full of jealousy and envy, of sin. That's why Jesus came. It wasn't all lights and babies and donkeys and good things. There was a war going on. There was a battle going on for our salvation. And to me, isn't Jesus still doing that today in our lives? That we look around our world and there's selfishness and evil and sin all around us. And seriously, part of it is the sin in our own lives. And I love the fact that Jesus still interrupts our lives to bring healing and restoration and that joy and that peace. And during the Christmas season, we see all those words, joy, peace. And what this reminds me of, that's what Jesus brought to a very sick world that needed him to bring it. And so I was going to say an amen. So I want you to say amen on that screen over there. So that was a warning too. But here's the last thing. And I kind of jumped around on purpose because the last thing that brings wonder to me, and I wanted to save it to the last one, is the gifts. The gifts that the wise man gave to Jesus. In Matthew 2:11, it says this. So the wise men saw the star, stopped over the house, and it says this. They entered the house and saw the child with his mother, Mary, and they bowed down and worshiped him. Then they opened their treasure chests and gave him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Like I told you, I'm going to ruin your nativity scene. The wise men weren't at the manger scene. It says here that they entered a house, that Jesus might have been a toddler. He might have been walking already. You know, he might have been already like full, you know, he was just a little child, but he wasn't a baby. They didn't show up to the manger. Sorry, you don't have to throw away the little kings. I'm just telling you the facts, and this is the story. But here's the most amazing thing. That when they showed up to worship. I think that's the most amazing thing. That these guys who grew up in another culture, another nation, another world completely, they recognized how important Jesus was. And they gave him these incredible gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And here's the thing. I don't think the wise men had any symbolic meaning to these gifts. I don't know. I don't think they were prophetic, but there's incredible symbolic and prophetic meaning to these gifts that they gave, which means a lot to us. And I'm going to tell you right now. So the goal, of course, obviously, they were giving it to a king, right? They knew he was the newborn king of the Jews. So gold represents royalty. Frankincense is it's a fragrance used in the act of worship, like it's an incense where they're worshiping gods or God. And so frankincense represented the act of worship. And here's myrrh, which was also a spice used for worship, but it was also a spice used for embalming dead bodies. And so here's something really, really interesting and symbolic that you need to kind of take from this, is that those gifts that the wise men gave was a gift of royalty, a gift of worship, and a gift of death. And I was kind of thinking about it. I'm like, wow, it kind of makes this sentence that here, the newborn king, who is worthy of worship because he was also God, also gave up his life to save the world. And he died for us. And when you look at that, that causes wonder in my heart. It's like, wow, this is why Jesus came. He came as a king, he was God worthy of worship, and he came to die and sacrifice himself 30 years later. And so, the one thing I wanna remind you, which to me constantly brings the wonder of Christmas back, is that he did it for you and me, that Jesus was sent for you and me. Those miracles I was talking about, the magi, wise men showing up in Jerusalem, the star moving, those warnings that protected Jesus. The end goal was for our salvation, was for your salvation. It was so that Jesus could live this life and fulfill the mission that God sent him on, and to bring joy and peace and to die for our sins on the cross and raise again on the third day so that we can be new creations in him. I think Colossians 1 says it best. Colossians 1 verse 19. For God in all his fullness was pleased to live in Christ. And through him, God reconciled everything to himself. He made peace with everything in heaven and on earth by means of Christ's blood on the cross. This includes you, who were once far away from God. You were enemies, separated from him by your evil thoughts and actions. Yet now he has reconciled you to himself through the death of Christ in his physical body. As a result, he has brought you into his own presence, and you are holy and blameless as you stand before him without a single fault. To me, that's also the Christmas story, that verse. That's why Jesus came. That's why God sent him. And you know, there's an old cliche, and I hope I'm not offending anybody, but you know, I heard a lot of Christians say, you know, you gotta make every day Christmas. And I think that's great. But here's the one thing that I realize, being Christian a long time, is yes, I wanna make every day Christmas and remind myself that Jesus came to save the world. But in reality, every day for me as a believer is Resurrection Sunday. It's Easter. Why? Because every single day I get to wake up and rise a new creation covered in the grace of God. Yep, you know what? I could have just sinned last night or, you know, whatever, and did something wrong, but I get to wake up, right? It says in Lamentations, right? That God, great is his faithfulness, and his mercies begin afresh every morning. That every morning you wake up in the undeserved favor of the Lord because of his grace through Jesus Christ. I think that is amazing. That you are forgiven as a believer, that you get to wake up fresh, a new creation, start anew. Doesn't matter what you did the night before or the week before. And that you can walk in the rhythms of his grace. I don't know, that's good. That's an amen right there. And so here, I'm gonna close. Here's the challenge, guys, is as you put up the trees, as you drink the eggnog and put up the lights, remind yourself that the wonder of Christmas is in Jesus Christ. That minus all of that, it's still a wonderful story. It's a wonder-filled story. And also remind you that it was all for you. It was all for me. It was all for your salvation because of Jesus Christ. So with that, let's bow our heads and pray. God, thank you for the wonder of Christmas. Thank you for this beautiful story that is a factual story that is filled with unbelievable, unexplainable things that we can't explain. The star moving, the Magi just showing up and knowing that it was a prophetic word and it had come into reality. And then the gifts they gave that meant symbolically means so much for us who live today, 2,000 years later, that we get to enjoy worshiping the King of all kings because he earned it by dying on the cross, buying our sins, paying our debt, rising from the grave as we rise new creations, that every single day your mercies are every new in our lives. I thank you for that in Jesus' name. I want to keep your eyes closed, and I want to encourage you. If you've never made Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior, I told you the Christmas story and how it ends. How it ends is that when he was an adult, he gave his life for you and me on the cross. And 3 days later, he rose again from the grave. So he conquered sin and death. That was his mission, to conquer sin and death in our lives. And I want to encourage you to say a prayer with me if you've never done that. Or maybe you're coming back. Maybe you're coming back to Jesus Christ and he's welcoming you back. He's going, I've been waiting for you. I've been wanting you to come back to me because I have so much to give you. And so if maybe this is the first time, or maybe this is a rededication to Jesus Christ, but if that's the case, can you just pray this prayer with me right now? Lord Jesus, I believe what happened. I believe in the miracles that led to your birth here on earth. And that as you grew up to an adult, you completed the mission of dying on the cross for me. And that you didn't stay dead. You rose from the grave 3 days later and conquered sin and death in my life. And because of that, God, I declare I believe that. I know that happened. And because of that, I want to give you my life. I say yes to you and everything that you have for me, Lord. And that Christmas to me now will not just be the lights and the trees and the eggnog. It's going to be your salvation, saving me, forgiving me, and giving me new life. I make you my Lord and Savior right now. I thank you in Jesus' precious name. Amen. All right, guys. Well, Merry Christmas, and have a great week.
Thank you, Pastor Tom. We hope you folks are blessed and encouraged by this message. Also, if you said yes to Jesus, congratulations. This is truly the best decision you can make. We wanted to remind you that if you jumped in later in the message and missed the chance to participate in the offering, no worries. There are three easy ways that you can worship God through your finances below. Thank you for joining us today, and don't forget to subscribe and turn on the notification bell so you know every time we go live. We love you and can't wait for you to join us again next week. We pray you have an amazing week.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here working in this place. And I worship you. I worship you. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are here and touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here healing every heart. I worship you. I worship. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, mending every heart. I worship you. I worship.
Light in the darkness, my God, that
the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
I walk the night.